we're going to go through some different examples. And the purpose of the PowerPoint today is to go through the renewal process and the spreadsheets and what you can expect from that. Okay. So to start off with, in most cases, health insurance contracts will renew on an annual basis. That's 1 year from the effective date. And an example might be that if you started your insurance coverage on January 1st, it'll go through to December 31st of 2015 and then renew on January 1st of 2016 with a new contract. A health insurance contract doesn't have to start on January 1st. It can start on the first of the month of any month and go for 12 months from that date. Okay. There are rare occasions where if an insurance company has its own particular pool that they have, they may require you to have a shortened or lengthened contract to bring them in line with their pool renewal.
Just out of interest, Jamie, with this, do you find that most of your clients or most of the businesses you work with, irrespective of what their fiscal accounting year is, normally go on a January to December year end for health insurance?
The majority of renewals are usually January. The other popular one is July. I have renewals 12 months of the year.
Okay. So. And is there anything you mentioned here? You might alter a multiple year contract, or brokers may, an insurance company, to get them maybe in line with the book of business. But is there anything that, in a sense, if you said you would sign up for 3 years now, you can get a better deal than by doing a yearly contract and then going back in a year later?
Generally, for small businesses that have less than 50 employees, a multi-year contract is not available. They may take you, in some occasions, they may take you out for a 14-month contract just to get them in line with their book of business, 14 or 15-month contract. Once you get into larger cases, I know some of the insurance companies are offering, 2 year rates that they will never go out for more than 2 years. So.
Okay.
The marketplace is too volatile for them to take on that amount of risk. Fully insured contracts. They are guaranteed renewable. The contract cannot be cancelled by the insurance company for any reason other than for non-payment of premium. Okay, so if you decline to pay your premium, then your contract's going to get cancelled.
I think this brings up an interesting little bit of a side point here. Is my understanding was before the new rules came in under the ACA rules, is that insurance companies, even though they would insure your company, potentially people on the plan could be denied coverage because of a pre-existing condition.
Under the HIPAA guideline, that was the Health Insurance Supportability and Accountability Act, back in 1997 under the Bill Clinton administration, everything was guaranteed renewable, and pre-existing conditions were essentially taken out. If you had continuous coverage, if you took a break in coverage, then an insurance company couldn't deny you coverage, but they could set a pre-existing condition. So if you had services done for, let's just use an extreme case, breast cancer,
mm-hmm.
And you hadn't had coverage for 6 months, and then you got coverage from Anthem. Anthem could say that particular medical condition would not be covered for the next 12 months. Okay, that has gone away under healthcare reform. So as of 2010, there are no pre-existing conditions left. So when you pick up coverage, you are covered for everything, whether it's pre-existing or whether you don't know what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
A business or an individual can cancel the contract at any time with a 30-day notice to the insurance company. Generally, that is not done unless you for some reason had to go out to the marketplace and shop the business for some reason, and you've got a better rate in mid-contract, then you might cancel your contract mid-term. Okay, contract is between the insurance company and the business or slash individual. The agent is a third party and legally represents the insurance company, but in practice, however, the agent really does represent the interests of the business. A good agent will always advocate for the business. Frankly, there's a partnership between the insurance company, the business, and the agent. And when everybody's working in concert, then you've got a good situation going. So no two insurance companies have the same renewal proposals. We've got two examples that we're going to go over in a few minutes once we've finished the PowerPoint. But whatever insurance company you have is going to have their own format and their own style. So you're going to have to work your way through that. An agent should be familiar with the renewals of the companies that they do business with, and so they should be able to guide you through that process. A renewal for businesses with 2 to 50 employees will be very, very cookie cutter. You'll get the renewal. It'll show you the your current rate, and then it'll show you the new rate, and then it may show you a few options that you have. There's not a lot of customizing done in this size of business.
But even though you say they're cookie cutters, you could still have maybe 20, 30 different cookie cutter plans to choose from.
Right.
Exactly. So in effect, there could be a lot of choice, but within any plan, if it says it's deductible is a certain amount and a co-pay is a certain amount, that is what it is. Nothing is flexible.
Right.
But you could still have a choice of.
Oh, yeah. You've got a choice of a number of. Yeah. They generally have probably a minimum of 10 to 15 choices for you to choose from.
Mm-hmm.
As I said, the renewal proposal will include both the expiring rates and the new rates and should include additional options. These options will only come from the current insurance company that you're doing business with.
I know we're going to go through some examples and you're going to show some, in a sense, just typical costings of premiums. But in day-to-day practice at the moment, am I right in thinking that the only way that your premium isn't going to go up from year to year at the moment is if you take away benefits from the plan?
Yes. I would say that that is probably, on a rare occasion, you may see a premium come down. But for the most part, the premium is going to go up with what they call, medical inflation, which is usually running around 10 to 12%. So if you're getting a renewal in the single digits, it's usually a pretty good renewal, and you should probably run with it.
So. But I think as we'll discuss in some of the examples, if you do get a renewal that really hasn't gone up at all, you most really want to be careful and make sure you really look out. Is the plan that you're getting the same as before?
Yes. Yeah, you want to be very diligent when you're looking at your renewal, and we'll give you an example in a few minutes of this, that occasionally they will arbitrarily change their plans, and they'll I think I discussed this a little bit later on in the PowerPoint. Occasionally they will map you into a different plan because they've abandoned the old plans and they're moving you to new plans. You've got to be pretty diligent in looking at what the new plan is, because you may find that either your premium has gone up because they've moved you to a higher level plan, or the premium may have gone down, but also the out-of-pocket costs for the employee when they seek medical services would have gone up significantly. So you've got to be pretty diligent on that. The agent that you work with can and should gather quotes from other insurance companies and display options on a spreadsheet. Again, we'll show you an example of what a spreadsheet might look like, and that's going to differ from agent to agent as well. Except for a few exceptions, there will be no medical underwriting required for this category. To gather quotes, the agent will require a census. that includes name, date of birth, and smoking status, and then residential zip code.
So this is going back to what we were talking about last week.
Right.
That if you're going into a new plan now, mm-hmm. and I know you're going to talk a little bit about potential some self-funding plans, mm-hmm. but in general, if you aren't able to go to self-funding and you're in the 2 to 50 full-time employees, then we're going to go to the community rating.
Right.
And just to clarify from last year, the community rating is a rate that's determined based on your zip code.
Right.
Whether employees are smokers or not. And right. Like I said here, I think it's just, there was one
age.
Other thing, age, yeah.
Yeah.
So in reality, you could be, it's going to be less flexibility than maybe there was before.
Right.
Even if you've got a really healthy workforce, because they'll go on just if you happen to be in a particular zip code.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. It's purely community rated. There's no medical situation brought into it at all.
But as you'll talk about later on, yeah. when we go through an example, because everybody within the I suppose the general business population, the insurance industry, mm-hmm. has seen that if all these community plans, community ratings, it would generally have been a lot more expensive than where their old plans were.
Right.
That now there's an entrepreneurship out there that's now looking at other ways within the ACA rules of other plans they can put together, which we'll
right.
discuss later.
Yeah, we'll discuss that. In fact, the next bullet point, on occasions, an agent may request proposals from a non-traditional source. And in this situation, the employees may need to complete a medical question, which you can do either online, which I would strongly recommend, or through a paper application. The online way is the better way to go because it's, believe it or not, secure. You know, the online applications that we use generally have banking level security. So all the information that they get is very secure, whereas paper, not secure at all.
Mm-hmm.
So. So early in the renewal proposal, the insurance company will illustrate the expiring premiums and then the new premiums and the percentage difference. So they'll show you both, show you the percentage difference. And as we were talking about a little bit earlier, insurance companies will change their plans frequently, and they will, to use an industry term, map you to what they deem to be the closest plan to the expiring plan. You should be very diligent in looking at what that new plan is and how it compares to the old plan, because you may want to make some changes.
Just when you mentioned here early in the renewal process,
what I'm saying is if when you're looking at a renewal document, the renewal should come fairly early, or the rate changes should come fairly early in the document.
Oh, in the document, okay.
Yeah.
But with respect to when you're thinking about renewing, so, if for example, for ourselves is obviously we're running from November to October our plan is
right.
Is when if we were coming up now, and I know you're talking to Christy, but when is an ideal time to talk to your agent in before the end of the year? So you've got plenty of time that you're not rushing, and you can maybe get the best deals. How do you, is it a month lead time, 2 months lead time, ideally?
Well, if you're in the ACA plans. You don't have a lot of control over the rates. But I would recommend that you want to talk to your agent probably 6 months before your renewal, even on a sort of general basis, just so that you know what's happening in the industry. A good agent will know the kind of renewals he's getting, and he'll be able to articulate that to you. So, you know, if he's seen a higher than normal renewals, you know, he can prepare you for that. He will generally receive the renewal from the insurance company probably about between 10 weeks to 8 weeks before the renewal. Legally, the insurance company is only obligated to get the renewal to you 30 days before the renewal. Essentially, if they do that, then they're not a good company, and they're not giving you time to react, because it does take time to react to this. But if a good agent is meeting with you 6 months beforehand, you can be slightly prepared for what might be coming down the pipe, and you can maybe develop a plan of action depending on different scenarios. Then once the renewal comes in, the agent should get that renewal into your hands as quickly as possible. He may not have the other insurance company options available at that time, but at least you have what the increase is, and then you can act on the plan that you discussed earlier.
And I think what you were saying when we were chatting earlier about this is, even though in the industry, I think before everything's got in place, everybody thought with the ACA it would be more cookie cutter, less interaction from your agent or less help needed from your agent. It's actually the reverse. In actual fact, I think you and I've been talking, as you say, is you feel as an agent now with respect to health insurance, you are able to bring far more value and far more help to your clients.
Right.
And you want them to call you because there's so much more that you've got to consider now, and there's so much more, I suppose, jargon that's out there that you want to make sure they understand what's going on. So for everybody, I think the one thing from here is, to everybody who's listening, is whoever your agent is, you need to make sure you utilize them more than just picking up the phone once a year to say, it looks like we're up for renewal, does this sound like a good plan? A good agent will be able to explain to you what's going on in the industry, what they're seeing, and what most is the most appropriate for your business.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. So, again, arbitrary changes could mean higher deductibles, co-pays, co-insurances, which will cost you and your employees more out of pocket. We'll show you an example of that when we go through the different renewal documents that we have. You want to consider the options that are offered by the incumbent insurance company. There may be an opportunity to save premium by selecting a different plan with a higher deductible and co-pays. You also should review the agent's spreadsheet, which illustrates options from competing insurance companies. Is it necessary to go out to the market every year? Maybe not. It depends on what the renewal is. I think you want to be prepared to do it. But if you can stay out of the market from, especially if you're medically underwritten, if you can stay out of the market every year, and maybe go every other year or every third year. An underwriter likes to see longevity with an insurance company, and they'll be more interested in getting aggressive rates if they know that you'll stay with them.
Yeah, so when you say stay out of the market, in effect, it would be using the same insurance company, so you're not switching from one to another.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
And like I said, everything we talked about at the moment is for the 2 to 50 employees.
Right.
We're going to go through just a little bit, a few slides on
51 to 99,
yeah.
Yeah. In the 51 to 99 category, that's 51 employees up to 99 employees. And when I say FTEs, that's full-time equivalents. That is a healthcare reform term, and I could do a whole PowerPoint on that, so we won't get into that too much right now. But the employers will be based on a combination of the insurance company's claims experience and the business's claims experience. Generally, for this size, it's more the insurance company's claims experience, so the whole pool. And then the business will probably have maybe 30-40% of their renewal based on their own claims. Okay. The renewal proposal probably will contain additional detail regarding high dollar claims, and may contain a loss ratio. That's the amount of claims paid out compared to the amount of premium dollars taken in. And then the agent may request employees to complete a medical questionnaire either online or on paper in order to gather competing proposals. Again, in this category, if you're fully insured, you're going to get very little information as far as how your business is performing from a claims point of view. I can get into a whole debate on the merits of that, but the insurance companies, carte blanche across the board, really do not share a lot of data in this category. They will tell you if you've had some large claims, and they may also give you what's called the loss ratio, which, again, that's the claims compared to the premium. Okay.
I'm assuming it's because of privacy and confidential purposes, they can't tell you who's claiming.
It's they'll use that as an excuse.
Mm-hmm.
Also, they'll say that a business that has 51 to 99 employees from an actuarial point of view is not a credible group, so you don't need to see it. Personally, I think that's wrong. I think businesses have a right to see, and there are ways to desensitize or de-identify claims so you can see claims without sort of knowing who they're coming from. So, you know, you're the guys who are paying the premium. We're getting into a bit of a debate right now, but I think you should have the right to see about how your business is performing. Insurance companies feel differently. Depending on the demographic profile of a business, they may want to consider a self-funded contract versus a fully insured contract. Fully insured contract, we went over this in a previous PowerPoint, I think the one we did last year, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
A business pays a fixed premium, and the insurance company pays the claims. Claims could be more or less than the premium paid. The insurance company retains all profits or shoulders all losses in that situation. Self-funded, the business pays an administration fee to a third-party administrator who pays claims on behalf of the business. The business only pays claims that are incurred. The business would purchase a catastrophic policy known as stop loss to protect against individual claims that accumulate over a certain threshold.
So basically, the self-funded one, in effect, what's happening is I'm assuming the premium, the employees, or the in that situation, it could be the fact that the employer pays 100% of the premiums, but it isn't a premium because it's just instead of paying the premiums to the insurance company, the people, when they go and have a medical condition, in a sense, submit an invoice,
right,
and the company reimburses it for them. And it's just taking the gamble of, is, are my premiums going to be higher than what I have to pay out?
Right.
And if for some reason somebody had a terrible case of cancer or heart, something like that, then it went above a threshold, then you just take out a high level of insurance, so you limit your loss to maybe 50,000 for the year or something,
right,
like that.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. That's a great point. Yeah. Yeah. Self-funding in the advent of healthcare reform has become a lot more popular in this category. People think that they can do better than the fixed premium that they're having to pay.
Which I think in one of the examples we've got, it typifies that you can show how that happened. Yeah.
Yeah. So, very briefly, we'll talk very briefly about the 100 plus. You know, this is a different category. And then in this situation throughout the year and with the renewal proposal, there will be a varying degree of claims data. So once you get over 100 employees, the insurance companies believe that you have enough credibility from an actuarial point of view, and they will share a certain amount of claims data with you. The renewal proposal will be based on the business's claims plus the insurance company's claims experience. Until you're about 500 employees, you are not actuarially fully credible. So they're always, up until that point, will take a certain amount of what the whole insurance company's claims experience is and offset that with your claims. Businesses in the 100 plus category have more flexibility with their plan design and the amount of plans offered. So you can offer multiple plans. You can offer 3-4 plans to the employees so they have a choice of a high 2 mid-level plans and a lower level plan.
So I think basically what you're saying here is, as we grow from a health insurance perspective, your options or your negotiating power increases.
Increases, yes. And certainly you have more flexibility in how you plan, design your plan as well.
But until we get to at least 50 employees, we really haven't got any flexibility.
Unless you're self-funded.
Unless self-funded, yeah.
Yeah.
So I was going to say, so I think now you've actually got some proposals.
Yes.
So hopefully everybody got the attachments, but we're going to go through the various attachments that Jamie's just going to go through. Hopefully you're able to print them off, where you can, because I know the wording's a bit small, but we thought it'd be a good idea to actually go through some live examples, and Jamie's just going to explain certain things you might just want to watch out for when you get your policies.
So in both the renewal examples that I have, these are for businesses that have less than 50 employees. The first one comes from Anthem, and generally, you know, you're going to get a lot of propaganda up front about Anthem, about controlling costs, and stuff like that. You know, I highlighted a few things that you may want to pay attention to as you're going through the renewal, like, you know, they've got some information about healthcare fraud. Fraud is a huge problem, both over here, and I'm quite sure it's the same situation in the UK.
Yeah, I think the bigger issue here, or there's been a couple of things, is unlike in the UK where your national insurance number, you don't really use it for anything, over right. here your social security number is used for everything.
Right.
And I think it was a couple of years ago that Anthem was, security was breached.
Right.
And what happens is that then maybe has knock-on effects that not only is it breached from a health insurance perspective, but then it's maybe breached for tax returns and stuff like right. that. And that's why it becomes such a big issue.
Right. The other form of fraud is fraudulent claims being submitted by providers to insurance companies under your particular name. So, yeah, in that respect, it becomes kind of a responsibility of the employees to review their explanation of benefits. This is a document that they receive whenever they seek services from the medical community, and make sure that that document says that they received the appropriate service and so on. If they're seeing something that they're not familiar with, they should definitely question it.
Okay. Just talking from here, so if somebody, and I think all of us, our biggest concern in a lot of business is hacking into our system these right. days, is if somebody, because in effect, if anybody hacked into here, it's hacking into Anthem, not into the employer, is it really?
Correct.
So in reality, from an employer's perspective, you can't, this is much for another reason that maybe you use a well-known insurer, because then you're hoping yeah. by default that they've got very good security systems.
Right, right. So, there'll be information on prescription drug costs, unhealthy lifestyle. Yeah, these are all tips that you might want to participate in to help control your costs, especially if you have medically underwritten rates. So let's flip over a couple of pages. There's a lot of information in here. And next, let's go to this page right here. Is there a way to flip that around? This page actually shows you the renewal. It'll show you the current rates. It'll show you the new rates, and then it'll show you the percentage change. It'll also show you the plan design. In this particular case, this client was offering two plans to their employees. They had one which had a lower deductible and office copays, and then they had a second plan which was an HSA or health savings account qualified health plan, which had a higher deductible and no copays, but everything was subject to a deductible. It shows you the premium, the new premium, the percentage change, and then the plans. And then if we flip through page down, if we can. Then what it shows then is the rates by employee, employee spouse, employee children, and family. So depending on what category your employee chooses, that's what the rate would be. And this is what you would develop your payroll deduction or employee contribution strategy on.
But I think what's interesting here is, as we'll see in the other one as well, is that by default, it seems like when you're a small employer, you will have maybe just two options put in front of you.
Right.
And you need to be aware there's a lot more, and you maybe should ask some more questions.
Right, right.
Is these options that are put here, just out of interest on the two here, would these be put together from United Healthcare and Anthem, or are these what the agent would normally put together as what they think are the two most appropriate?
No, generally, Anthem will give you, they'll give you the full menu of their options. With Anthem, it comes in a different document. With United Healthcare, which is the next one that we're going to be showing you, it's shown later on in the document.
But in reality, I think if you are the employer and you receive this through the post, you need to be aware that this isn't necessarily the plan that your agent thinks is best for you.
Right.
So it's more than likely that it might not be.
Right.
And that you really need to, even, because I think in the Anthem one we got here, it doesn't give a lot of other options.
Right.
So if you aren't really aware of it, you might think, well, these are the only two plans that I can do.
Right.
Whereas when we look at the United Healthcare one, when you slip through to the back pages, there's a list of maybe 20 or 30
right.
that you can use. So it's just, I think the takeaway from here is when you get this, don't take this as being gospel.
Exactly.
Go back and talk to your broker, your agent, and sort of make sure you fully understand it and see what other options you have that might actually suit right. you better depending on how the business is changing.
My best advice on that is to keep on asking questions. Never take anything for granted. Keep on asking questions until you're absolutely satisfied that you've got the best deal possible.
And to be honest, based on what you're saying, is if you get sort of pushback soon in that process, then in reality, I would say from my perspective, it would be an indication that whoever you're working with is most probably not the right person to be working with, because you and I talking and understanding a little bit more about the health system is it's very complex, and it's not a yes or no thing. It could take right. an hour, a couple of hours to go through stuff, and if the agent isn't prepared to do that, it's most probably not the right person to be working with.
That would be a good statement, yeah. This page basically breaks down these employees and what their cost is and what type of coverage that they're taking, whether it's single. And insurance companies are notorious for codes, and they have codes for the type of coverage. S is single, F is family, T is, I think with this particular company, it's employee children, and it's then it will indicate the number of children and so on. Oh, no, sorry, that's the plan that they're on. So plan two, plan one, so on.
And I think that this as well is that they, with respect to now with the community rating,
mm-hmm.
it's basically you'll just pay, as you told your zip code and that, you'll pay a rate. And
right.
Don't they just group people into certain age brackets now? And if you happen to fall in that age bracket, that's your rate.
Right.
And it doesn't really make any difference whether you're fit and healthy or whether you aren't quite so fit and healthy, you still pay the same premium based on an age bracket.
Mm-hmm. That would be right. So let's move on to the next renewal, which would be from United Healthcare. Now, under this particular plan, United Healthcare made changes to their plans, and this is an example of one that you want to be very diligent on. Because if we just scroll back up to the top, this plan, their current plan on the left-hand side is they have a $1,500 for the network. They have a $1,500 deductible, $3,000 for the family, $25 office copay, and then 100% co-insurance. And you'll notice if you move over to the right-hand side, which is the renewal plan that they are proposing. You could, if you're not paying attention, you could think, huh, I'm getting a 10% decrease. That's awesome. Let's put this to bed and go away. Well, you do have the same deductible, but the out-of-pocket maximum is increased from $4,000 to $6,850. The office copays have increased from $25 to $35. And then the co-insurance, that's your responsibility once the deductible is met, is 80% rather than 100%. So in this case, you may be saving money on the premium, but the employees are going to see significantly more out-of-pocket costs when they seek medical services. And in the case of this insurance company, they changed their plans, and so they mapped you to this particular plan because they felt it was the closest to what you had in the past. So in this situation, you want to be aware of that, and you probably want to be looking at some different options, either through United Healthcare or even options outside.
So yeah, so as I suppose just a bit of a refresher from last week, so where we have a plan deductible there, that would mean, so in the first column where for a single person it's 1500, that right. would mean you would have to pay 1500 out of your own pocket before any insurance kicked in?
Any insurance with the exception of a couple of things. First of all, you'll notice that there's an office copay, which is the third row down, of $25. That would not be subject to the deductible. You just pay the $25 and you're done with that office copay. The second part would be the pharmacy costs of $10 for generic, $35 for a formulary, and then $60 for non-formulary. That would not be subject to a deductible. But if you had any kind of outpatient surgery, if you had inpatient care, that would be subject to the deductible.
And once again, just for clarification, when you see office copays, that normally means as if you were going to your GP in the UK.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And you'll notice that it has $25 and slash $50. $50 would generally be for a specialist, so that would be something like a cardiologist or, as you call them in England, a consultant,
mm-hmm.
A joint specialist or something like that. Okay. So in this situation, obviously, you know, the premium's going down, which is nice, but also the plan is a less rich plan. So you want to review some options to see if there's anything available through United Healthcare that might be better suited to you.
And I think, can we just go back up to that previous page?
Yeah.
I think the other thing that you did mention on last week is talking about now under the ACA, you have platinum, gold, silver, bronze level.
Right.
And the other thing, just to notice on there, at the top there, the plan on the left is what they deem to be a gold plan. And it would appear that they're going to try to put you onto a silver plan.
Right.
So in effect is, just by almost by default, the way that hopefully the system should work is by going from gold to silver, you're giving something up.
Right. Yep. Yes, exactly. Okay. Are we good? Okay, let's go down to here and let's scroll down a little bit. So these, and with United Healthcare, they have given you different options to choose from. The one with the arrow is the one that they are mapping you to. And then the ones above and the ones below are options for you to choose from. If you look at the third column, it'll tell you what metallic level each of the plans are, and obviously platinum is the highest level, gold is the next highest level, silver, and then bronze. So the top plan here, that's a bronze level plan. Obviously, you know, it's going to be significantly less expensive, but also the out of pocket to the employees is going to be significantly more as well. So you would want to, with your agent, because obviously your agent is going to understand the plan. The plan designs better because they do it every day. Go through these and see if there's something that is going to be better suited to your employees or closer to the plan that you had the previous year.
So the way that these work, and I know it doesn't come up on the screen, but the next page actually gives the premiums on
yes.
the right-hand side.
Yeah.
And the premiums basically as you go down get more expensive because obviously you've got better benefits.
Right.
But where we were talking about that if you've got say you've got a workforce that's a combination of young employees and older employees,
mm-hmm.
From a 2 to 50 employee, could you potentially take out two plans here and have like maybe a bronze for, because once again, everybody's covered by healthcare.
Right.
But could you take out a bronze plan for, that? In a sense you could say, if you're a youngster and you want to be part of this, your premiums are cheaper and you most probably won't be drawing on it, so it's quite appealing to you.
Right.
And somebody maybe more a little bit older, might have a family, a little bit more risk, puts into another plan so you can have two plans operating together?
Yes, you can, absolutely. And again, you know, in a future sheet, we'll go over some contribution strategies as far as that is concerned. Okay, let's go down. Okay. Let's scroll down a bit. So, yes, yeah, so this... Essentially, what you want to do in this particular case with United Healthcare, you want to print these two pages out and put them side by side because they will map each other side by side. But Again, you know, at the top, you've got that bronze plan, and it'll show you the premium. And then you scroll down, and you can see the one that's highlighted in blue. That is the plan that they're proposing to you. But you can choose any one of these plans and find something that is better suited to you. Or you can accept the proposal. But again, keep on asking questions until you're fully satisfied that you have the right plan for yourself.
But I think once again, the takeaway from here is that when you're given two plans, there's a lot more you can choose between.
Yeah.
And potentially, depending on the size and the cost, you might be able to mix and match one or two plans, depending on how large your workforce is, to give them the benefits they want and also make sure everybody's covered by health insurance.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So let's move on to the next one, which will be this spreadsheet right here. Okay. So this is an example of a spreadsheet that I use with my clients. This shows, in this particular situation, it shows this business has 10 employees, and it shows the current plan, and then it shows some different options. And you can see the increase or decrease over the current plan for each of the companies that I'm illustrating here. Now, what I want to bring to your attention here is if you've got a relatively healthy company and they're relatively, probably an average age of in the low 40s, you really may want to consider some of the self-funded plans that we talked about a little bit last week, because your premiums could be significantly lower. In this case, the two blue columns, this is a self-funded option, and the, I guess that's pink option, is also a self-funded option. But then you can see the two gold plans to the far right are significantly more expensive than the two medically underwritten plans.
And the main difference there is, and this is what you're seeing in reality now, is that the two on the right are under the ACA, so the community
right.
ratings.
Right.
And because they are taking in less factors and everybody's getting grouped in, they are becoming far more expensive. And because of this, now groups have come out to bring in the three middle ones, which are self-funded, more on the right. old co-op basis.
Right.
To try and help smaller employers and stuff like, or employers, to now, in a sense, well, let's actually try and do our own actuarial results
right.
and give everybody a better result, as opposed to paying these huge increases under the ACA.
Right. Yeah.
Just we've got about another 10 minutes, but at the moment we don't have any questions at the moment. So if you do have any questions, you can go in and type them in, and we will try and answer them in the time. Otherwise, we will get back to you afterwards. But I just want to remind you there are questions. You can ask questions.
So this next spreadsheet also shows different options, but also we get into the contribution strategy that you want to consider with for your employees. In the UK, you're used to having the national health system, and everything's paid for, and you know it's a common thing for businesses that from the UK that are opening businesses over here of wanting to pay for all the insurance. And I'm here to tell you that it is not necessary to do that. The rule of thumb is probably anything from about, you should be paying about 80% of the premium to even 50% of the premium, depending on what your budget is and so on, and the type of employees that you might have. In this case, the client that I was working with here, they wanted me to show them examples of different ways to structure this payroll contribution. You know, currently they had a 25% employee contribution, so the employer was paying 75%. They wanted to look at it at a 50-50 point of view, and they also wanted to look at continuing at a 25% point of view, And then if we, I think this will scroll down and show a third option. Yes. And then also they wanted, okay, I think that's still 25% as well. But you can, an agent should be able to put this together and show you different options and show you what your costs would be and what the employee's costs would be. And you can decide what is appropriate.
But I think, once again, the takeaway from here is, from a cultural perspective, whereas in the UK, most probably the nobody expects to ever pay anything out of pocket for healthcare.
Right.
So if there is a benefit, then in a sense, a lot of times it is, as we talked about, it's picked up as a benefit in the UK, but it's really just a benefit. You don't pay the cash for it. It's just the tax.
Right.
Whereas in the US, the different cultural thing is that there is an expectation that, especially for owner-managed businesses that tend to be a little smaller,
right,
that it's not going to be 100% fully funded, and people are aware of that. And like you said, and like you said, is I know for ours you make us sound like we're a bit cheap here, because we only fund 25% of our employees' insurance, and they fund the other 75%. But it's far better to start on the lower side, and as the business gets going, increase it.
Right.
Because then it's a nice perk, as opposed to doing too much to start with, because you have to cover everybody, so then cutting it back is
right,
just not good for staff morale.
Right, right. That's a very good point. But the one thing I can't stress more is that employees expect to pay a certain amount for their health insurance.
Yeah.
Over here. Okay. So let's go to the last sheet. And this is just an example, again, that I put together for a client. This would be an election sheet. In this case, the employees are offered two medical plans, and then a dental plan and a vision plan. And they can see, you know, and my personal philosophy, and in the particular case with this client, they like for the employee to see what the full premium is, so they understand that there is a cost beyond what they're paying. And then it shows, it breaks it down by per pay. So in this particular case, they pay twice a month, and then it shows what the employee contribution is. And then there's a section for them to elect the plan or waive the coverage. As, you know, frequently, an employee might waive the coverage, A, because they might be getting it through their spouse's place of work, or they're just deciding not to take it.
Yeah. So I think what just on the left-hand side there is just whether it's employee and spouse, employee and children and family, whether they're waiving it.
Right.
And I think, as you talked about before, is that once again, is I think from a UK perspective and a cultural perspective, is you feel that you want to make sure that all the family's covered.
Right.
Once again, over here, it is the cultural way that if you have two spouses working and the one spouse can be on the other person's, on their employer's plan, you should make them be on their plan, because otherwise it can increase increases your risk. Yeah.
Yeah. Especially if you're not on a community rated plan. Yeah.
So I was going to say that's great there. And the other thing we talked about, which you're on here, you talk about waive, is we've been talking about this earlier, where you can elect to waive out of the plan.
Right.
But you should make sure that you've got more verbiage there or something to cover yourself as the employer to say that you've given them the chance.
Right.
They have affirmatively said, I'm going to waive. Now, in general, my understanding is if they waive, then they could not get back into the plan until the following year.
Unless they have what's called a qualifying event.
Mm-hmm.
A qualifying event is marriage, birth, death of a spouse or a family member, change of job status, and there's probably one other, but I can't bring it to mind right now.
But basically, if they waive, then they've waived for the whole year unless one of those events or
yes,
something similar to that
yeah,
happens, and then they can elect in if they want to.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just got a question coming in here talking about the sharing of the costs. It says, is it only the premiums that are shared between the employee and the company, or also what about co-pays and deductibles? Does an employee ever pick those up, or are they ever able to pick those up?
Employer.
Yeah, the employer. So obviously with the premium, we've been talking about how best to structure it from a finance perspective and also from a morale perspective. But then we also talk about the deductibles and the co-pays. Does the employer, in your experience, ever fund the employee to help pay those?
Generally not. But I'll give you an exception. The exception is an employer may select a higher deductible plan for all their employees, and then they're put in, and we referred to this term last week, a health reimbursement arrangement,
mm-hmm.
That will cover a portion of the deductible, and mm-hmm. possibly some of the co-pays, but generally not, unless they're selecting a higher deductible plan to just reduce the premium.
Or else if some of the, like you said, the health reimbursement account, or maybe a health savings account where right. the employer funds it.
Right.
Which then, in effect, they can draw down on to pay yeah. their expenses. Okay.
Yeah.
We've got about 5 minutes to go. If anybody else has got any other questions, is there anything else that, if there was one thing or two things that you would want somebody to take away today, the presentation, what would be the one or two things if everybody had been asleep for the rest of it? To sum up what we talked about in the last hour, what are the one or two things that you would suggest that people need to pick up or remember from today's webinar?
The first thing is be very diligent in looking at your renewal. As we went through this, and companies are changing their, especially in the 2 to 50 marketplace, companies are changing their plans very frequently, and they will arbitrarily map you to a plan. You need to be very diligent and make sure that you notice that and take the appropriate action to either move the plan to something more appropriate for your employees or even just accept the plan. And then the second thing is questions. You cannot ask enough questions.
So, well, as I say, with that said, Jeremy, thank you very much for the time you spent with us last week and this week. And I hope everybody, I'm sure they have, that everybody who's been on last week and this week, I'm sure they've picked up one or two great points, so thank you very much indeed.
You're very welcome.
Just before we go and sign off, I think as everybody is aware, we try and have these webinars specifically focused around the differences between doing business in the UK and business in the US to try and make sure that everybody who we work with is educated on the differences. If there's other topics that you specifically, whether it's your business or you've talked to somebody that you'd like us to look at or addressing, please email me and we'll put it together. We are at the moment in the throes of putting together another webinar, most probably end of January, because obviously we're getting close into autumn, and once we get into December, I have to smile, but sometimes I think the UK does shut down for business sometimes. But at the end of January, we're thinking it would be a good idea, and this, the topic then, we're going to be talking about employment law in the US and trying to really focus on the differences between the UK and the US, because this is one of the biggest areas, I think, where there's the biggest disconnect between how employment law works in the UK and how it works in the US. So I think that'll be a very useful and practical session. So we will send out more details with respect to that, but that is our intention, to have another one of these webinars towards the end of January on employment law in the US. So thank you everybody very much for attending. And if you have any follow-up questions, you do have Jamie and my email, please email us. But thank you very much. And I would like to wish you a good rest of the day. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.